Okay.
You meant the pitch having a foul smell? That's what you meant. Shh. Okay. He went to explain. It says that what is an indication? Why is there amuse? Impoverishment? Because it says, because the gasei ruach. A person is arrogant, he has no relevance to wealth. He's anius. So firstly, the Gemara said anius meant anius, material. Material impoverishment. The Gemara concludes, not only that, it's mainly impoverishment of Torah, anius by Torah. But he says, but still, even according to the conclusion, it's still that. So he says, why? So he gave the example, he explained, because the shefa brocha comes from Hashem. That's brocha, the flow. But so the person has no relevance, doesn't reflect the characteristic of Hashem, therefore he doesn't have the shefa brocha. This is what he explained. So he says over here, 2:4, that's 8 lines up from the bottom. Ubechonis adover b'zeh, he says, you could test factually. In the Odom, you don't find osha by gasei ruach. People who are arrogant, you won't find wealth. So we, of course, you'll find. No, put it this way. How could you be a gasur paying that kind of tax, real estate tax? It's not possible. They beat you down continuously. What I'm saying is like this. You'll always find, if a person's a Russia, you'll find wealth, even his arrogance. But let's say a person is an ordinary guy, mainly. Ordinary person. And he's a gasruach, he will not find wealth. By that kind of person, you're not going to find wealth. An arrogant person, ordinary person. Okay? Brilliant. He's handsome. He has what he has. Yeah. No, which means if you meet certain criteria, you could have it. Whatever. Right. Block it. And there's so many variables that determine what you get and what you don't get. Let's a person, he could be a gas ruach, but he's a machshav Torah. He values the Torah education. For whatever reason, because he realizes if he doesn't invest in that, it's over. But he's an arrogant guy, and he wants the glory. Maybe Hashem will give him wealth, because he understands, appreciates, Hashem will allow him to be the one. I mean, there's so many variables. That's what I'm saying. To live just high on the hog, we are gas ruach, Hashem's not going to give it to you. Unless you're a person who's a Russia. Russia, goods, that's the payoff. The payoff, that's Russia from the Tovlo. Right, so it's the payoff's okay. It has nothing to do with your merit. It's just because you have this little merit, you have to be paid off. Right? Otherwise, of course, Hashem doesn't want you there. In all of my book. Okay, let's see. That's what he's saying. But you only have you're connected to that if you reflect who Hashem is. You're you have a certain simpleness to you. They can see that only He exists. Doesn't say that. Nobody exists in existence, only Him. This is not only He opened the depths of the earth also, to show it's only me. Ani v'lo acher. Okay. get to Shmos, we'll discuss it. Okay, we left off on page 15. Chaber had said that when a person urinates, he should not hold on to the shank of his penis, but he could hold, he should hold on to the, from the ridge, what we call the corona downward, away from the body, because a person, if he becomes aroused, he could actually, cause him to waste seed, to expel seed. But he said, but if you're married, you don't have to be concerned. But even if you're married, midas chasidus, one should be careful. That's the Chaber. Okay, let's see. It's more in Nida. What he says is more. Lamato. Because when you're urinating. Lamato. Afilo ma'eva bikishu imutu be'ator lamato. He says, even if the penis is hard, so you'd say because it's already, it's hard, he could be, it's more easily to be aroused in that stage. No. If you're holding him in Ator Lamato, you don't have to be concerned. That will not in any way affect it. Menesha Motzi, Rotzloma Shalidei Nigyosa Bagid Boli Dechimu Behiru Biovlozev. Silence, Svorim. Yes, you can swear. Sikri Kabbalah, the Sevisha Shavaita brings this, that. Because he reads these things that come from Israel and Bells. That a person, before he goes to sleep at night, especially this word on Yom Kippur, two things. That a person should do his bodily function before he goes to sleep. Because if you have all that waste in your body, it's mechamim saguf. It actually causes a certain internal heat, which actually could cause a person to have a wet dream. When he sleeps, it causes him to actually to expel semen. And also, that a person should keep his feet uncovered, meaning from the ankles down, shouldn't cover his feet totally. So because the feet are exposed in those days, then indoor heat, right? So therefore, it was cold. Since your feet are cold, so you're cold. The person's cold. So being in that state, the person's not going to in any way, the body's going to reach that level of heat that ultimately will cause him to be in this state. That's why they didn't let him sleep. They didn't let him sleep. And they denied him certain foods they wouldn't allow him to eat. Like it's brought that certain things you shouldn't ever give because it's maybe it was increases the semen. V'chomer ovor hazer, ayin be'evin ezra simchov gimel, and there's a great liability for the sin, hu nosui. Why, if you're married, you're permitted, even to, when you urinate, to hold it from the shank, v'yishlo pas b'savo, right, because he has the outlet. Ben yitzo toko kakak, he's not affected by his desire to that degree, because he could actually satisfy it. Vim he nido, mentioned this, I was reading the Chaber, she's not available to his wife, she's in nido. Oshu bederach, he's away, he's out of town. Also, ayin be'evnes simchov gimel simdal, v'afilu nosi en mutl hoshit yodo la'amo klal, elab shu tzorach l'nikovo. And this was speaking about, even if you're married, a person is not permitted, he's only permitted to touch his aver, right, that, only for the sake of urination. Because otherwise, I mean, anybody can be aroused. If we definitely should not. You know, the Gemara says, I once said, see, Alan remembers this one. Why was Rabbi Yudan Nasi called Rabbino HaKodesh? So it says, and the Gemara says, because he never put his hand below his waist. Never. Because he was so careful, because if he was concerned that you never know. You never know what could happen. He never put his hand below his waist. That's what he's called Rabbi Noah Kodesh. As I said, the Gemara says in the Bava Metzia, the Rabbi Yudan Nosi, there was an incident where a calf, not a kid, it was in the urinary tract, was already in the urinary tract. So a calf was going to be slaughtered, and the calf came running to him to seek refuge. So it buried its face in the corner of his coat. So Rabbi Yudan Nosi says, go to your slaughter, because for that you were created. So because Rabbi Yudan Nasi showed an insensitivity to the calf, he immediately developed a urinary stone in his urinary tract, and for 13 years, whenever he urinate, he'd be in such excruciating pain that you'd be able to hear his screams above the screams of the flocks and the herds. That's how he suffered for 13 years. 13 years later, it was a calf or some kind of a weasel gave birth, and his maidservant were sweeping into the streets, into the together with the trash, which ultimately they'd be killed. So he told her to retrieve it. So he showed sensitivity. So because he showed the sensitivity, immediately it resolved itself. He was healed. Because that countered, initially, was lack of sensitivity. This was like oversensitivity for that. Therefore, he was healed. So I asked the question, why did it have to be in the urinary tract? Why? He could have suffered other ways. He could have had arthritis in his arm. I mean, why that? So what I said was that very often a person goes and he, you know, we speak about the Muslims, but Yisur Shalabo. Yisur Shalabo. The person sins, he deserves to be punished. But a tzaddik, the Gemara says, he has Yisur Shalabo. Even if he doesn't sin, the person doesn't have any problems in life. Everything is smooth. There's no resistance. If that's the case, there's no concept of tzaragra doesn't apply. You say, according to pain, that will determine the degree of value of the mitzvah. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu creates problems for the tzaddik in his life, even if there is no sin. Even if he doesn't sin, the tzaddik has difficulty. He gives him difficulty to increase his reward. So what are you talking about? That means he didn't sin. So what did he do? So we explained, even if it's not a sin, but if it's not exactly perfect in like sensitivity, there is a consequence. That's Yisur Shalava. Like, this is Yisur Shalava. But how do you know it's Yisur Shalava? How do you know? Maybe he did sin. Maybe Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi did sin. The answer is, where did the stone manifest itself? In the urine. There's no way he could have sinned, because when the person sins, it usually manifests itself. It has to do with the way he sinned. But since it manifests itself in the urinary tract, and he was Rabbeinu HaKadosh because he never put his hand below his waist, that's a clear indication that he's Yisur Shalava. That's what I said. You follow me? I want you to be able to say it over Shalva Shuvah. Again, a tzaddik who's a special tzaddik, when he suffers, it's not because of sin. Okay? It's because, and why? Because Hashem wants to increase his reward by putting roadblocks, making things more, it's obstacles in his way to do the mitzvah. So he has to apply himself to a greater degree, so the mitzvah should have greater value. And Hashem wants him to have greatest reward. That's the concept of Yisur Shalava. Now, let's say a tzaddik, a special tzaddik, all of a sudden suffers. Has a problem. Who's he? See? Not such a tzaddik. Otherwise, why did it happen? So how do you know? So the answer is, so you don't know. If he said that means he's supposed to be the example of what a tzaddik is. Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, he's not such a great tzaddik. It's a chil Hashem. So now he's going to be punished for the sake of Yisur Shalav and that, but it's not a punishment. It's only to increase his reward. But it has a negative side to it, because what are people going to say? Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi is not the tzaddik you think he is. So what happens? But where does it manifest itself? In the urinary tract. It can't be because he sinned. Because if he sinned, it wouldn't have manifested itself there, the pain. Because he's Rabbeinu HaKadosh, because he never puts his hand below his waist. So the sin can't be associated with that area. So why does he have this difficulty? The answer is Hashem wants to increase his reward. No, because he's been corrected for 13 years. That's the reason. He was aware. He had to he had to have an opportunity to demonstrate a sensitivity to counter the lack of sensitivity. And you find with Hogar and Sori, maybe. Maybe it didn't present itself. It didn't present itself. When it presented itself, he jumped at the opportunity. That's why he jumped at it. But you see the same thing about the Chil Hashem. What happened with Hogar? When Avraham Avinu took Hogar as a wife to bear a child, it was Sora's idea. Right away, Hogar right away had a disrespect for Sora. Says, look, it's clearly it's a facade. Here, I just married him. I become pregnant immediately. She's been married to him for all these years. What happened? She's supposed to be such a great tzaddik. Why did it happen? Right? That's what Hogar said immediately. And she showed a disrespect to her. It's a chil Hashem. If people speak this way, that's a chil Hashem. Sori Imenu is supposed to be that the holy woman. Seems to me she's not so holy. We continue. I'm not going to explain sorry, man, but I'm just showing the point. Why Bermuda, I'm not saying Hashem had it in the urinary tract, because otherwise it would have been a chil Hashem any other way. He's doing the interest in the tzaddik. But here it has this negative side, so, you know, something, it's not worth the whole thing. The people wouldn't, no, people understood it. When he, people understood exactly where the suffering was. It couldn't be for a sin. Because he was known by the world as Rabbeinu HaKodesh. And his holiness was because of this specifically. I don't know. You know how? Oh, Alan is asking a phenomenal question. Yossi, you got to hear this one. Baruch Hashem, you came today. Because he asked the question. Came with the day you asked the question. Just how do people know? Everybody's saying below his waist. It's separate. Okay. He never put his hand below his waist to touch his body. But how do people know that? Private peace. Versus the end of Brochus, Reb Kiva, when he was a student, I think it was Reb Lezer. Reb Lezer goes in to do his bodily functions. Reb Kiva follows him into the bathroom. So he says, excuse me. He says, Tori, the Tzarach and the Illumo. No, sir. Reb Kiva says to his Rebbe, Tori, the Tzarach and the Illumo. I have to see the first. This is Torah. This is not. What kind of privacy is over here? I want to learn. How do you conduct yourself when you do your bodily functions? So then afterwards, what happens? Reb Kiva becomes Reb Kiva. One, I think it was Ben Azai, he follows him to the bathroom. He's a Reb Kiva, says, excuse me. So Ben Azai says the same thing. Torah, the Torah, and the Lumos. This is Torah. This is not, there's no such thing as a private. What am I here to do? This Torah thing, you know, it's like the doctor has to examine the patient, excuse me. You know, what do you think you're in the hospital? What is this, a resort? Well, sometimes you pay the price, you think you're in the resort.